Thank you for coming, everyone. As we celebrate the life of Mother Mansueta today, we are going to start by singing praises unto our God. And the songs that we are going to sing are are some favorite songs of Danay. So let's all sing Sweet By and By.
By faith we can see the far, for the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on the beautiful shore. In the sweet shore, we shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirits shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessings of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Father above, we will offer a tribute of praise. time shall be no more, and the morning brings eternal bright and fair. When the save of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder,
hard to give a welcome to such event like this. But as what the Bible says, that there is time for everything. Time to be born, a time to die, and there is a time for everything. So today, it is my distinct honor and privilege to welcome you all in behalf of the Mannings family and the Salon family. I would like to welcome our visitors, our friends, co-worker, and those who have come today, and even those Genis family who are in other part of the world, United Kingdom, Jordan, in the Philippines, or wherever you are. You are welcome to this celebration of the life of Nanay Mansing. I know your presence today is very special to the Salon and the Mannings family. And I would like to encourage you to continue to be with them, to support them, and to inspire them, and to embrace the whole family in this time of need. Nanay Mansing, in many ways, had touched our lives. Every time I visited to their place, she always made me comfortable. She always makes sure that before I go home, I have food for my mother-in-law too, and my family. She is very generous. The last time before she died, like a week before she died, when I went to their house and asked some banana plant, Jeannie gave me some plant. I said, no, there's still a lot of plants right there at the back of the house. Let's go and get one. And she was the one who showed me, okay, this is the one. Get everything what you need. She was so generous, very loving. And when I call her, I always make jokes with her. I said, Nana, you are the best mom or friend that I ever have in the church. And I made some jokes with her, and she always said, Nonoy, katar sogid sa imo. That's an Ilonggo means you are so funny. So Nanay Mansing, you will be missed, surely missed, not by my family, only me and the rest of us, that you have touched our lives in so many ways. May this model of goodness and generosity will be a reflection of her beautiful life that we should remember always. Before I sit down, I would like to read a promise from the Bible. In John 11, 25 to 26, it says here, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he or she may die, yet he shall live. And everyone who believes and believes in me shall never die." May these words of encouragement from the Word of God will be our hope and encouragement that there is life after death.
I'd like to follow that reading from the Bible. I'd like to give and reiterate a promise that was written by Apostle Paul to the family and to all of us today. It is found in Philippians 4, verse 7, and the Bible says, "And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Jesus Christ." Shall we all stand for prayer? Father God, who art in heaven, you are eternal. You love us so much that you are with us today. We gather today to celebrate the life of our departed loved one, Mama Mansing. We are here to celebrate a life of love, a life of integrity, and a life of grace. A life that was a legacy to the left behind. Today is tough, dear Father, for all of us, especially for the family. We are in deep sorrow for the passing of our dear beloved mother, sister, a friend, a grandmother, and a great-grandmother. But Lord, we are here to rejoice as well and have the joy because you are our God. You know what is best for your children. And today, as we celebrate and recall the memories that we have with her, may we are able to expound the great love of God through her life. As we look back on the life of this dear mother, let us not forget that you brought her to life. You molded her. And the life that she lived, it was a life of Christ. And may all of us, including the children and the grandchildren, will not forget of the life that she has left behind, that they will follow the path that she has left to follow Jesus as they live their life till the end of life. Father, we ask that you grant us your peace, that you grant us your comfort, especially to the bereaved family, that they will look up to you and have that great hope that this is not the end as they say their farewell and goodbyes today. It is just a temporary, because in that great day when you come in the clouds of heaven, that will be the grand day of resurrection, that we will see each other again, including Mama Mansing. So grant us your presence today. Grant us your Holy Spirit. Abide with us, and may everything that will be said and done today, it will be granting honor and glory to your holy name. Because, Lord, you are here with us, and your Spirit with us. Grant your Spirit and your comfort and love to the family, because we ask all these things in the blessed name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Let's all be seated. Thank you.
Thank you, Echoes of Grace, for that beautiful song. You know, I am not Alan. Alan is the one showing in the program. Supposed to be Alan is the one to deliver my mom's life sketches. But my son Rico told me, "Mom, I think it's better for you to do it." And I said to Alan, "You know what? You are spared this time, you know, so I'll do it." Oh my goodness. Rico, come on. You know, this is my mother's life sketches, but it also includes my memories with her. So who would tell that I could not do that? So here it is. Mama, you will always be in our hearts. My mother was born on September 12, 1937, in Kabangkalan, Negros Occidental, Philippines, the second child of 9, 4 girls and 5 boys, survived by 2 sisters, 1 brother, parents, Diosdado Antikin and Elena Antikin. When she was only 8 years old, my father saw her playing in the river with her friends. My father, who was 15 years old, with 7 years gap, at that time, riding in his carabao, was very concerned about the safety of the kids. When he saw them playing in the river, he told the kids, "Hey, stop playing in the river. Not safe for you. So you need to go home." My mother did not like that. In her mind, "Who are you to reprimand me? You are not my father. Watch out when I grow up, and if you happen to like me or love me, I will give you a hard time." So, no wonder my father served 3 years to the family before they got married on September 19, 1957. A simple civil wedding ceremony in the courthouse in Kabangkalan, Negros Occident, no, actually in Pigkawayan, North Cotabato. It just shows that my father truly loved my mother. The union resulted to 12 beautiful children, survived by 11 children, 19 grandchildren, and 3 great-grandchildren. My mother was a loving and faithful wife to my father. Just lately, she asked my father, "Papa, kung mauna ko kuhaon sang Ginoo, mga sawa ka ulit?" Papa said, "Hindi na, tigulang na ko." Siling ni mother, "Hindi ko magpati." In English, "Papa, if you go first, you will still get remarried?" Papa said, "No, I'm already old." Mama said, "I don't believe you. Mama is so cute and beautiful." My mother was the best encourager. When I went to her, "Mama, I'm so stressed at work. I feel like I want to resign now." She will say, "Oo, resign ka kay makakancer ang stress." In English, she said, "Yes, resign now for stress cause cancer." She always gives me hope when I am down, and do the same thing for her family and friends. She even consoled Rose, giving her a hug when Charles passed away. And she said, "Rose, don't cry. You will see Charles in heaven someday, but she will cry first. My mom is so cute and beautiful. My mother is so loving and generous to all her children, sisters, brothers, relatives, stepfamily as her own. I remember when I was young, our house is always full. Aside from 12 kids, my mom is more than willing to accommodate her siblings' family in need, not only for months, but for years. That's how loving and accommodating my mother is. She cooks lugaw, rice soup, when I am sick. She always prepares my baon, lunchbox, every morning. If there is no leftover food at night, I will have rice and boiled eggs for my lunch, making sure I have protein in my meal. She'll offer me her last money or to anyone when we need it. When Rico is hungry, she will say, "Let's go to Chick-fil-A, Rico." Of course, Rico is so excited because Chick-fil-A is his favorite fast food. Not only Rico, but all of us. When children in the Philippines ask for money, she could hardly sleep until she's able to send it. After she sends it, she still worries if they receive it because there is no callback received from them. Maybe no signal. And then she will feel at ease when she already know that they have the money. There are times that she doesn't have money, and one of the children asks for money, she will cry to Papa. And then Papa doesn't like to see Mama crying, so Papa will open her wrapped cash or savings and gave to Mama the amount she needed. My mother is so cute and beautiful. My mother was family-oriented. Even though our house is tiny, an IPA house, she makes sure we have a very long table for all of us to fit in. She always makes sure we're all in the long table for breakfast and dinner. The food is divided equally to all siblings. And sometimes, trading of food or services happens during that time, especially for those who eat a lot. After eating, the scheduled siblings will be crying in front of the sink, looking at the so many utensils, pots, and pans to wash. No options, though. They will wash it. Sometimes Mama will come to the rescue. My mom is so cute and beautiful. My mother has a joyful spirit and welcomes her guests and friends with smile every time. Even with my ex-husbands, she treats them the same and welcomes them with a big smile every time. She found joy in the most simple activities and happiness in connecting with loved ones. She's always pleasant to be around and is easy to please. She had a good time. Even during the time when she had a stroke, when I took her to the Advent Health Hospital Apopka, during the admission, testing was done, and the doctor requested her to smile. She gave a cute smile to her doctor and froze that smile for long. That was the last smile of my mother imprinted in my brain. I did not realize that would be the last smile. My mom is so cute and beautiful. My mother loves walking and gardening together with Papa every morning, taking pictures, sending balikbayan boxes to the Philippines, full of used clothes, shoes, canned goods, and to make it more exciting, she put chocolates on its boxes. She loves doing FaceTime with the children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, siblings, relatives, and friends. She learned how to operate her cell phone through the help of Farah. Thank you, Farah, for doing that for my mom. Of course, he loves to learn. My mom is so cute and beautiful. To name some of her friends that made my mom happier are Nanay Pinang, Auntie Myrna, Auntie Eleanor, Mama Esther, to mention some. My mother was faithful believer of God and committed to obey God's word. I remember when we were young, she always gathered us to worship every morning and evening. Friday is the busy day to prepare for Sabbath day. Every Sabbath, she makes sure all of us in the church. She always tells us we have to always obey God's words so we will not be burned to hell. That's why she made it clear to me that when it is her time to go, not to burn her. Siling niya, nagapaninguha ganit kita nga magtutumtubtub sa katapusan, tapos sunugon lang ta. She said, we stay faithful to God till the end so we'll not be burned, and now we're going to be burned. This is why my mom made it clear to me that he doesn't want to be cremated. My mother is so cute and beautiful. I want to tell you a little bit of our lives when we were growing up. My dad was a farmer in 1962 in Carmen, North Cotabato. And then in 1966, he decided to move us to the town proper of Carmen, Cotabato, because to prepare me for my school, so I will be closer to my school. And my father changed career from a farmer to a businessman. He has doing wholesaling and selling of rice and corn. And then my mom's helped Papa in the business while taking care of the children. And then in 1967, my mom was an active member of the Carmen SDA Church, and she became the superintendent of the church and later became the elder and the treasurer of the Carmen SDA Church. And then during 1971, there was a civil war going on in Carmen, so Papa moved us to Midsayap, Cotabato. and Papa was still doing the same business. And in 2003, I petitioned my parents to come over to join me here in Florida. And in June 2004, they were able to get their visa to join with me. Since the time they were staying with me, and Mama is so happy that she has a lot of friends. And, you know, FaceTime is very important to her. I remember when her cell phone was damaged, it took like 1 week. It took 1 week for the cell phone, not really the cell phone, but the SIM card to come. That was the loneliest moment I saw my mom, except for the deaths of her siblings, of course. So she really loves the FaceTime. So my mother was always looking forward to be in heaven together with Papa, her children, her grandchildren, her great-grandchildren, family and friends when Jesus comes. Mama, you will be missed, for you are sleeping for right now, but it will not be long. Papa and all of us will be with you again in the resurrection morning when we see Jesus face to face, where there is no more separation, no more pain. In Revelation 21:4, it says, in Revelation 24:4, you know what was that, right? Is that Revelation 24? I want to read that one, but I thought I have it in my thing. Sorry. Revelation 24:1. God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things had passed away. Thank you.
I'm grateful and honored from Jenny and Papa and the family for the opportunity to speak today. I'm grateful to celebrate the gift that Mama shared with me and my family. We are not related, but I called her Mama. 16 years ago, from the moment I met her, I could see her in her eyes. She was kind. She was strong. She was loving. She was good. I like her and Papa immediately. I remember one particular time when my mom was very sick. Mama and Papa will walk 1 mile every day to visit my mother. They were friends. They will be knocking at our door wee early in the morning, just before I'm ready to go to work. "Tug now," she'll say. She will say, but I don't understand at that time. I saw her shivering, and it was cold that morning. I have not forgotten that word since. I offered to pick them up, but they will say they love to walk. She was very gentle to my mom, taking care of her with no reservation. She gave it all from morning to dark. Every time we attended a prayer meeting at Jenny's house, or if it happened that I stopped by in their house, I can hear her asking, "Nagkaon ka na, Art?" Which is mean, "Did you eat already?" Mama has that special touch and smile. Now that she's gone, I won't be able to find her face and sweet smile in the crowd during the prayer meeting. I will miss that. In one of our prayer meeting, we are grouped into three. It happened that Mama, Papa, and I was in that group. That was the first time I heard Mama prayed in her dialect. And she has a deep connection with her God. I figured that if she prays for me with that same conviction, no demon could ever even touch me. There was solid strength in Mama's relationship with Jesus. You could see it in her face and hear it from her voice. That is why I have no doubt that whatsoever that when she woke up from her sleep, she will be escorted in the presence of God, her friend and Redeemer. She is resting now, but I think her often, because I cannot thank her enough for the love and care she shared with me and my family. So in a way, she is still here. He's still reminding me that God is greater than anything in this world. Still reminding me that the love can be found in the loving hand like her. Still reminding me that I don't need to understand Bisaya, because true faith does not need words. Please rest in peace, Mama Salon. See you in the beautiful resurrection morning.
Morning, church. Oh, it's afternoon already. When my family moved to Florida, including my mother, that was 1998, we were in Tacoma Park, Maryland. But when we moved here, we were in Ponciana, Kissimmee. It was too far away to drive to church. But Mom said, we are going to Filipino church every Sabbath, no matter what. I said, Mom, there is a 5-minute walk church over here. And she said, no, I want to see my friends. And, you know, my mom met so many friends in this church, including Art's mom, who is gone already, Nanay Tortal, which is A.N.'s mom, and of course, Mama Mansing, Jenny's mom. I call them the Golden Girls, because they all love to sit in church. They love to sit together. And I said, Mom, come over. No, I'm going to sit next to my friends every Sabbath. And also, I noticed that Mom will cook two different kinds of food for potluck. I said, Mom, what is this for? And she says, you know, we have our own potluck. And sure enough, all this friends of hers, including Mama Mansing and some of the seniors, they have their little potluck outside the fellowship hall. I said, why? Well, the reason, because they don't want to wait long line. And of course, they're old and hungry, so they said, we have our own potluck. So, and sometimes I would join them because they like to eat their, you know, favorite pinakbet, which is mixed vegetable with bitter herbs, dried fish, and other Filipino dish. Mama Mansing is very special to my mother. She considers Jenny's mom as her best friend. When we moved to Leavenworth, Kansas, for my job, Mom was very sad because she missed her friends here in Florida, especially Mama Mansing. We stayed in Kansas for 5 years, but my mom and Mama Mansing, keep on calling each other almost every day, right, Jenny? Almost every day. They were on the phone, and I don't know if they're doing FaceTime, I'm not sure back then. I heard them talking about their children in the Philippines, and most certainly their grandchildren and great-grandchildren. They also talked about how many balikbayan boxes they sent to the Philippines, and you mentioned that too. How many balikbayan boxes did you send this month? Well, you know, that's the big box full of goodies sending to the Philippines. And they enjoy sending that to our family back home. And also, Jenny, do not be surprised if you see things missing from your house. You might see them in the Philippines when you go home. That's true, because I saw some of my things at home. When we were in Kansas, my mom and sister said that we need to move back to Florida. Because first, there's no Filipino church there in Kansas. And I know she missed all her friends, especially Mama. So I accepted the first job available just to move back here because of my mother. She's very, you know, lonely over there. And so, you know, when you're Filipino, you want to be with the Filipino group. So Mama Mansing and my mom was planning, on our way home here in Florida, Mama Mansing and my mom was on the phone and says, "What day are you coming?" And my mom said, "Friday, we'll be there Friday." And okay, we will wear the same dress to church Sabbath. And I said, "Oh yeah, yeah, we have the same dress. We'll go Sabbath." But you know, it was that Friday that my mom, that when we were traveling, we had an accident, and my mom was killed in an accident that Friday. And so we had that accident in Georgia, and my mom did not make it to Florida. After a few years, I let go of my mom's clothes and gave some of her favorite clothes to Mama Mansing. And every time I go to see Jenny and I saw Mama, she'll wear some of my mom's clothes, and I would have to give her a big hug because it's kind of remind me of my mom. And I just love her so much. And right now, whenever we go to Jenny's mom, she always has something for me to take home. The relationship between mother and child is like none other. Jay and I have same experience, being the oldest among our siblings, brought our parents here in the United States, immigrated here, and became a U.S. citizen. And I'm thankful to God about that. It's so much for them for here, instead of being home, but still, they think about their family back home, their children and grandchildren. And then also, Jenny, we remember when you said, "Oh, I'm going to take mom to doctors." And same thing with me, I'm going to take mom to the doctor. 2 years ago, they went to Washington, D.C., Mama and Papa and Jenny, to apply for dual citizenship. And I was still working there in Aberdeen Proving Ground. And Jenny brought them to D.C. for the first time. Remember? And it was cold. It was like fall and beautiful leaves, different colors. And Mama said that she loves those trees. And my husband and I took them. We drove along Georgetown Washington Parkway. And it's just beautiful, you know, the color of different leaves there. Mama loves it. And she said that, "I love the color of the trees, the leaves, but I don't like the weather, it's too cold." I admired Mama for her strength at her age of 83 years old. "Jenny, I was glad when you asked me to stay with you at the hospital that night before the doctor pulled that plug the next day. We have the same experience losing our mother, which is not so easy. I am so thankful for the blessed hope that God gave us. Mama is sweet, loving, and soft-spoken. And I will miss her so much." And I will end with this. And I know Jenny took my verse, but I'm going to read it anyway. Revelation 21:4. "And God will wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall be any more pain, for the former things are passed away." What a promise from our loving God. And I cannot wait for the day when we see our dear mother again.
Magadan Hapun Kayu. Good afternoon. Mama was always delighted with my execution of abbreviated Tagalog and Ilonggo. One of my earliest and fondest memories of Mama was when she and Papa initially arrived in America. I would be reading, and my reading would be interrupted with this sound of water being turned on and off, and on and off, and on and off. And when Jenny came home, I said, you know what? I said, honey, I think Mama's watering the plants in the bathroom. Tell her she doesn't have to do that. And Jenny told me, she said, oh, no, she's conserving water. Because when back home at the pump, you know, you just didn't let the water run incessantly, continuously. And, you know, she was immediately impressive. I was impressed by her inner strength as well as her outer strength. For example, it was nothing for Mama to load up effortlessly two large, heavy sacks of rice and keep it moving. And, you know, I was raised to help the elders, to don't let women carry large loads and things like that. But Mama was so fiercely independent, and she could just effortlessly carry out those tasks. Mama became a surrogate mama for me. I lost my own mother much too soon in life. And Mama was very easy for me to spoil. If there was any debate or discussion about where we were going to eat on an outing, I knew in my mind, whatever Mama wants, that's what we're going to do. You know, that's what's important to me. Mama had a superior work ethic. She was so thoughtfully generous with her time. And she had an innate spirit of service. For example, if I had a load of clothes in the dryer, if it were one of the kids, they'd just take your stuff out, put it on the table, and keep moving. But Mama did not do that. She would just fold it, and it would be just impeccably folded. It looked like a machine did it. And, you know, I'm a contract professional speaker, and oftentimes I receive marketing materials and marketing collateral that I have to assemble at home. So I had all of these materials spread out. It's a long dining room table. I had them spread out. And so I'm assembling my marketing kit one by one. And I remember Mama picked one up that I had assembled and completed. And after perusing it, you know, I went to take a call. When I came back, I had three boxes of materials. Mama had assembled all of it. And it was just perfect. And that was just, that's just par for the course for Mama. She would do things like that. And I remember there was one of the largest conferences. I was going to be the keynote speaker in Phoenix, Arizona. And they were expecting 1,500 people at this conference. And I guess I was visibly and understandably apprehensive about this conference. And Mama had this wonderful, intuitive, innate ability to perceive how you were feeling. And she would approach me, and my name is Kevin, K-E-V-I-N, but she did not call me that. She called me Cabin, like a log cabin, and that's the way she pronounced my name. And she said, Cabin. She touched me on the arm, and she said, Cabin, what's wrong, Cabin? what's wrong? And even though Mama probably only fully comprehended every third word, she would just conclude, yes, you're going to do good. You're going to be fine. And she was delighted when they had video recorded it. I don't know if you remember. And she watched me for the first time at conference in Phoenix. And she was so delighted. And she had this wonderful childlike curiosity. For example, I received a big box. It's a dual monitor kit. And I could tell she couldn't wait for me to open it. She wanted to know what was inside this big box. And so I said, Mama, this is a dual monitor, and it's going to allow me to, you know, look over the features, advantages, and benefits of my proposal while I engage my client. And I'm going into it, and she said, that's good. And she didn't really get all of it, but she just would just say, that's good, Kevin. That's good. And I just love, and already miss, the essence of her presence. As many of you know, Jenny and I divorced in 2014. And Mama, shortly after the divorce, she said, Kevin, I am still your mama. Papa is still your papa. He is your papa. And she just had this wonderful, sweet way. And she was very easy to love. And as Jenny said, one of her favorite things to do was she was continuously thoughtful of her family back home in the Philippines. And I remember when I would get her something for her birthday or something like that, she would be, of course, grateful for it. But then as an afterthought, I would realize, I just have this sudden realization, oh, you know what? I bet your mama was thinking I was going to give her money for her birthday so she could send a portion to the Philippines, because that's where she derived a significant portion of her happiness, was having adequate provision for her children and grandchildren at home. And there is something that exists in this world. It's called philoprogenitiveness. And that's the natural love and affection and dedication and duty that one has for their offspring. And Mama had that. And Mama, we're going to miss you. We already miss you. And we appreciate so very much your life of service, commitment, and contribution to us. I will cherish the memories of you in my life. That is what has given me peace right now. That is what has given me comfort. And it's my sincere wish and hope that your memories, individual memories with her, does the same for you. Salamat. Thank you.
I've had my grandmother in my life for as long as I can remember. They came from the Philippines partly because of me, actually, because I think it was, we were still in the old house because we moved and we went, the house we're in right now is the newer house that we're in, but we used to live in a different house when they came over. And they came over so that they could take care of me. Because I used to stay with Rodney's grandmother, but I started growing up to, I was like running around too fast for her, I guess. And so, because I was a really hyper child when I was younger. And then, my mom thought it would be good if her parents came over so that they could watch me too. And so I was lucky enough to have her in my life for as long as I can remember. And Lola, she, one of the things she would do was she would cook, but not all the time. She would usually have Lolo cook, because Lolo was, he's usually the one who makes all the soup and all of that, and he's really good at that. And Lola is, like, she doesn't really like to cook very often, unless she has to. But one of the things she would do for me was when I was going to school, she would always make my lunch for me. And I would upset her sometimes, because sometimes I didn't eat my lunch at school because I was kind of like embarrassed to eat it in front of my friends. Because like the thing she would pack for me was like, it's not like a normal lunch. Like she would give me like eggs and rice. And that was like weird compared to like what they would usually have at the school. And so I was like, sometimes I wouldn't eat it. And when I'd bring it home, she was like, why didn't you eat? And so, and that would hurt her feelings. And so to get around hurting her feelings, I wouldn't eat it at lunch. But what I would do instead is because I didn't go home right away after school ended. I stayed in aftercare. And so I would eat my lunch then when it wasn't at lunch. So, yeah, I got around that way. And even when I got to high school, she stopped packing lunch for me, I think. But she would still give me money so that I would have something to eat. And she was always very thoughtful as to, like, if I had food and if I was eating. Every time we would go groceries at Walmart, even after we already got everything, she would always urge me to get more. She would always tell me to like get more food, even though I already got everything I wanted. And yeah, she was, and also like what my mom said in her message, she would always treat us to eat out wherever I wanted, because I was spoiled. And yeah. She was just, it's just so hard for me to believe that, you know, she's already resting now. It just happened so fast, and I really wasn't expecting it. I was honestly expecting, like, she would stay around much longer. And, yeah, she was a very important part of my life. Her faith in God is something that I will always have, because she's the one who passed that down to us. That's it for me.
Mm-hmm. Hi. I'm EJ, and I don't know why, but my heart is beating fast. Well, there is a little video that I made. I'm not sure if they're able to show it. All right, you can go ahead.
What is that? What are you doing, videotaping? Oops.
Yeah. Merong boslot. Hindi ko gusto boslot.
Ano kaya tama man gani yung boslot eh? Ano hindi ko gusto boslot?
Merong boslot.
Happy New Year!
Happy New Year, Lola!
Happy New Year, Lola!
Happy New Year!
Happy New Year to Lola and her friends.
Lola.
Happy New Year.
Lola.
Happy New Year.
Lola.
Happy New Year.
No, Lola.
Happy New Year.
Saka Lola nagparin.
Happy New Year.
Lola nagparin.
Ang Lola nagparin.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Lola nagparin.
Lola. Happy birthday, Lola.
Happy birthday,
Lola. Happy birthday, dear Lola. Happy birthday, Lola.
All right, bye bye.
Bye bye.
I'll go to.
Oh.
Bye bye.
Okay.
All right, Lolo.
Salamat
po. Ingat.
Kayo,
ah. Oh, ingat. Oh.
See, I like to take a lot of candid shots of memories. I don't know where exactly to be, where to begin. There's just so much that I can remember. But I grew up in Philippines until I was 6. So during that time, I don't remember much of. Yeah, I can't remember much except for the house that they lived in had a net underneath, and I loved going under there all the time. Yes, there was a mosquito net, and I'm light enough to go on it and play around on them down there. But when I went back to Philippines when I was a teenager, that's where my first impression of Lola was. She was holding 2 bags of rice. And yes, I was really like impressed because she's, you know, my grandma, and here she is like holding the 2 bags, and like, oh, EJ, and then like, and then you know, so I'm really proud of my grandparents. They're very strong. Lola, we have, I don't know where I should start with this, but I get along with my Lolo a little bit better than Lola. The thing is, with Lola, she has a way of teasing. She teases me a lot. Let's say that from my perspective, it's like she has a mastery of saying a thing a certain way that's not like right, and I have to like tell her what's the right thing. Like for instance, with my girlfriend in California, she always teases me about her, and she says it a certain way, and I'm like, I can't just hold back and not correct it. She, like what Uncle Kevin said, she has a way of knowing how you're feeling, and it's like she knows how to do some ways of speaking that makes you test yourself and how to respond and respect also. And so she's been that kind of influence in my life that helped me to respect and care for. And but we get along. As you can see in the video, I'm always there, like emphasizing her. and also about the Balik Bayan boxes, like she's very devoted to her family there. And also, like, I don't know if it's true, but there are some clothes that I love, and I can't seem to find it. So I guess it's in, you know, someone in Philippines is gonna enjoy it more than me. But I can tell that she's really committed, and she cares. She has a big heart. Always sending to Philippines, because, you know, majority of our family is in Philippines. With Lola, I'm gonna miss that kind of interaction with her, and just being able to appreciate life through seeing them together. And hoping I can also experience something like that too, just the simple things in life, and be able to just enjoy what you have, and that relationship. Like, they are a really great example. While sitting down, there was just so many things going in my head of what I would like to say, but as of right now, I really can't come to, yeah. But this is, but yes, thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak. I'm not really much of a, up here to do something like that, like this. I'm not used to this kind of thing, but thank you. I'll see you again, Lola, soon.
He's been faithful to me. Looking back, His love and mercy I see.
I believe Sister Mahalia sang the song that Mama would say if she is given the chance to speak. But of course, we will not allow her to speak now. But there's a word, there's a text that I'm going to read from the scripture. It's in Revelation chapter 14, verse 13. This is John the Revelator saying, I heard a voice from heaven saying, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. When the Icos of Grace were singing the song, Blessed, Blessings, it fits perfectly to what our dear mother has experienced in life, because God has been faithful to her. Mama has been blessed so many ways.
she was blessed to have somebody saw her while playing in the river. Even though she pledged that she will give a hard time to Papa, but he relentlessly pursued her. What age, Papa, when you started courting her? I believe she was so young. But God blessed her with a loving, faithful husband. It was my privilege few years ago, right here, when I officiated at their, was that 60th? 60th wedding anniversary. It was fun. It was a happy occasion. And I did not give them counsel on family relationships because they are the experts. We should learn from them. She is blessed with 12 children. Anybody can beat that? I got only 4. But I thought I'll have more. During those times, blessings are counted by how many children you have. And I say, she was so blessed to have an eldest daughter like Jenny, who loved her so unconditionally. I know of some occasional disagreements between them, and yet Jenny's love for her and her love for her daughter remained strong. What a blessing to have children who will stay by your side until the end. I pity those who are in the nursing homes. I give Bible studies with Brother Hewitt in those nursing homes, and one of the complaints of elderly is their children don't remember them no more. It would last a year, no one ever come to visit them. Not Nanay Mansing. She was so blessed that she stayed with her in the Apopka Hospital at the Orlando South, and even until the last breath of her life, Jenny was there. Mama was so blessed. And when you are with a person that is blessed, you too is blessed. She's blessed with friends here in church. She's blessed with trip to Europe. I saw their pictures, how people were walking so fast, but Nanay or Mama will just walk. And poor Papa have to wait for her across the road. I've never been there except in the airport. She's more blessed than me. She saw the palace, right? They went to many places, and her daughter brought her to see those beautiful places there. She's so blessed. She's blessed with 3 citizenships. Philippine citizenship, American citizenship, and when she accepted Jesus, she became a citizen of heaven. That's the greatest citizenship. And as I mentioned, she is someone who don't just say things that are discouraging. You know, when you talk to some other people, you hear stories of problems and criticism. When I visit Mama, she won't tell me even complaints about anybody. And on occasional visits, she would hand me an envelope. I thought, what is this, Mama? This is for you, for your gasoline. I said, You ought to save your money. You have lots of children, grandchildren depending on you, waiting for you. But she insists, when I open it, $20. Imagine that for someone who ought to help and is not receiving that much, and yet so generous enough to share the blessings. Why? Because she is blessed. I remember Lot. Why did he decide to go with Abram, Uncle Abram? It's because he knew God was blessing his uncle. And it's good to be in the company of people who are blessed, because the blessing overflows to you. Watch out to be with people that are cursed. No, I don't think God is cursing people these days. But people who experience the faithfulness of the Lord will always have good things to say. She is blessed. She is blessed with grandchildren. How many grandchildren? 19. I have only 2. 19 grandchildren and 2 great-grandchildren. Oh, 3. I'm late. The clan, the tribe increased. And I won't speak too long because it's already almost 1 o'clock. And according to our program, we'll only be staying here until 1 o'clock. I'll be sharing to you one of the greatest blessings that Mama claimed. It's in 2 Timothy chapter 4. This is the words of Apostle Paul when he was about to die. It says in chapter 3, 2 Timothy verses 7, and 8, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. In the future, there is laid for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. Oh, what a blessed promise that she claimed. We are not given the authority to judge people who will go to heaven and will go to hell. It's the Lord. But based on her faith, us, an echo to the hope of Apostle Paul, she has this faith that when the Lord comes, there's a crown of righteousness waiting for her. Even in her death, it's a blessing. And even after death, blessings. Oh God, our Father, our Master, loves to give blessings to those who acknowledge Him. And the words of comfort and encouragement that I'm living with you, family, and those that are watching in the Philippines, in other countries of the world, your mom is blessed. When you serve and worship the God she served, who is faithful, you too will be blessed. Not just with money, not just with long life, but the blessings of contentment, the blessing of that great hope that when Jesus comes, there's a crown of life waiting for her, and not only for her, but all those who love His appearing. God bless you all.
We are in the finishing touches. I would like to let you all know that in our difficult times, in behalf of the Salon, Manning, and Marikit family, I would like to thank all of you. It's really difficult to mention all your names because I know it's going to be in hundreds. So, first of all, I would like to have a special thanks for our church pastor, Pastor Katangay. Pastor Katangay was, even though only one same person allowed in the ICU, Pastor was able to get in there just to see Mama and pray for my mother and anointed my mom. And also, a lot of my friends visited in hospice. I really appreciative of that. And a special mention, the three of my beautiful gandas, Rachel, Rose, Allen, oh no, four. Allen, Rose, and Malu, they stayed with me in this journey. And Malu actually slept over with me over there with Mama. She accompanied me there and treat me for dinner, lunch, a lot of them. Some of them dropped by in the house to bring food. Oh, Maria Tambunan, I cannot forget your food. We still have it. The curry bangos and the eggplant with tofu. You know, Papa doesn't eat very much, but at the time, she had an appetite, and I was so thankful. And also, Ate Krising dropped by some food. Also, my family, the Manning family, came and visit and brought some food. And it was nonstop every evening. And I don't have to cook. You know, there's just a lot of outpouring love. It's not measured by money. I know that a lot of you have contributed some monetary support. And I'm very thankful for that. But above all, your presence and your prayers and comforting words. It's just blessed. I am just so blessed. My family is blessed with blessings of church family and friends. It's just I feel the outpouring love when we are in these times of grieving. It's hard, but you made it a little bit easier because of your love and support. And I know Auntie Ima is busy there in the kitchen, and Jana, and I'm very thankful for all of you and all the participants, the Echoes of Grace. I know I am out in your group, but I will come back. And thank you so much for the beautiful songs. And I know all of you are very eager and a willing heart to just help me out. I cannot forget, and I'm very appreciative of your love. Thank you. And also a special mention for Shannon, the Loomis Funeral Parlor. Thank you so much for taking care of my mom. She is so beautiful. Thank you.
May I ask the congregation to please stand with me? Father in heaven, you have not made us for darkness and death, but for life with you forever. We praise your name for all who have finished this life loving and trusting you, for the example of their lives, the life and grace you have given them, and the peace in which they rest. You've heard our praises today of your servant, Mama Mansueta, for all that you did through her, her span of 83 years, and gifts of character. God, our Father, we thank you now for all her life, for every memory of love and joy, for every good deed done by her, and every sorrow shared with us. We thank you for giving her to us and for our memories of her. We thank you for the rest in Christ she now enjoys. We thank you for the glory we shall share together when Jesus comes. Meet us in our sadness, O Holy Spirit, and fill our hearts with praise and thanksgiving. Without you, we have nothing to hope for. With you, we have nothing to fear. Thank you for your words of eternal life we heard today from Pastor Dan and everybody else who were up here in the podium, that lifted us from anxiety and guilt to the light and peace of your presence and set the glory of your love before us. We pray all these for the sake of our risen Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. And your people said, amen and amen.